That's such a good song. That's going to be in my head for the next 8 hours. Thanks. I have songs that have stuck in my head constantly. I wish they were ones I chose. But I have a 9-year-old daughter. And I take them to school every day. Every day that I'm home, which isn't all the time, but it has been lately. And I'm trying to expose them to lots of music. In fact, at a point, JJ said to me, "Is there any song on the radio that you don't know?" Because I would sing along with the songs that I would play, but secretly I was playing my own playlist. I'm sorry, honey. So then she started, she's now old enough to know how to work an iPhone better than I can. Which I don't even, like she'll grab my phone and she'll just be on it for seconds. And I'll get it back. Everything's changed. Everything. And I don't know how to get it back. So I've now had to ask her, can you fix this? And she just goes, no. But she is now, she's now found Apple Music, she's now found Spotify on my phone, and she's created her own playlists. And so when we ride to school in the morning, she asks for my phone, and I let her have it, and she plays her own playlists. And then myself and the twins have to subject ourselves to all of her music, which is, any ideas? What? I heard Taylor Swift, yes. So that'll Harry Styles, yep. All right.
Slayer.
No, that's what goes on immediately after drop-off. It's like Slayer, Metallica, Howard Stern, whatever. And then who else am I subjected to listen to? Oh, there's this new song. I don't know who sings it, but it's something about a sunroof. Somebody know what I'm talking about? I think it's called Sunroof. The fact that you don't know this makes me so happy. But wait, did you just say? Yes, that's that song. Great. Now that's gonna be in my. Can you play AC/DC again? Give me some AC/DC. I need it right now because otherwise that. Any AC/DC? Anything. Give me something. Just pick a song. Any song. What?
You play.
You sing.
Oh, me? No. That's, I wouldn't. All right, never mind. We missed it. Let's just get to some questions. A song for me? Well, okay, so I do force my children to listen to my music. They have not called Child Protective Services on me just yet. And oddly enough, they do enjoy some of the songs. They really enjoy Cannonball, which is funny. I haven't played a whole lot of the new album to them, which I don't know, a new album came out yesterday. We just kind of dropped that one. But apparently it did really well, or is doing really well. Steve keeps texting me. He's like, "Dude, we're like number 3 on the country charts." And I'm like, "What chart? Where are these charts?" And, okay. Anyway, I think largely because of people, you and people like you out there who tolerate us and and may enjoy it. I appreciate it, and thank you, because it gives me an opportunity to do something I never thought I could do, or thought I could do, which is play music. And I bring that up simply to tell you one more little insight into my personal life, and that is that my youngest daughter, Era, has taken to the piano quite well. She's six, and she hears a song and then goes over and picks it out on the piano by ear. She's never had a lesson. She's never, and I asked her, should we get her lessons? And I don't know if there's any piano players or piano teachers in this room. You may disagree or agree, but they were like, she's 6 years old, and just let her play. Because if I force her to sit down for an hour, then that might force her to not like it. Because now all of a sudden she has to do it. She doesn't have to do it right now. She just pops on for a song or two, and then she goes and plays in her room. Then she comes back, and I'll start playing like something, and she'll come in and play with me, and then she'll leave. And so she plays all day long, but it's intermittent. And the other day I was picking out a Sturgill Simpson song, and then she just comes up behind me and starts picking it out too, and now she plays it perfectly, better than I can. And she's six. So look out for that one. All right, let's get to some questions. How about over here?
Hi.
Yeah. Hi.
My question is, you have been an actor and also a director, but now you're also an executive producer. And my question is, what did you discover about the making of a TV show that you didn't know or didn't realize was such a big part of it when you were an actor?
Very good question. So the producing is really describes all of the behind the scenes things that it takes to make a production come to pass. I was always just simply part of the production process. So there's a writing process. Then once the script gets decided upon, which is way more intensive than I anticipated, then that script then gets sent to the production, and the production then facilitates that script, makes it into it, shoots all the days and the camera, the angles and the this and the that. Then that all gets sent to the editors, the post-production. Then they put it all together and put the music behind it, all the soundtracks and the visual effects and all of that stuff. They put all of that together, and then it gets sent out to you. So there's quite a process that happens. I was a part of one of the pieces of that puzzle. I have now I've now been a heavy part of another piece, which was the pre-production. But even more in front of that, that I didn't even realize, was the getting a show off the like onto air is a monumental feat. The fact that that any show that you see in its completion gets completed and gets sent out to you has beaten so many odds. It is an incredible winner in odds that are stacked against them. Because there are so many ideas, there are so many shows, there are so many things that get pitched to a studio or pitched to a network that get said no to. In fact, I heard this recently, that the safest thing a studio executive can say is no. Because if they say yes, then it's their fault if it fails. If they say no, there's no fault. So it's easier to say no than it is yes, simply from their job perspective. So for somebody to look at the show like Supernatural and say, yes, is an incredible, is incredible odds. Then for that show to find an audience and be accepted is also, I mean, how many shows are out there now? I mean, you know, it's like shows come and go constantly. To find an audience, also, you know, a long shot. And then for it to last as long as it did for 15 seasons, that just doesn't happen. So it's literally like winning the lottery. There's so many things stacked against you. So being on the developmental process now, I understand it from a different perspective. And I've even talked to Jared and Misha and Rob and Rich and all of my like actor friends that have been in this industry as long as they have. Like, the fact that we even have jobs is astonishing. There are a lot of very, very talented people in our industry, and some that never get to be exposed. Their talent never gets to be presented, and it's a shame, but it's understandable because there's so many check marks that have to be checked off before it could ever be released to an audience. And so the fact that that shows make it to air is just no, I mean, and I'm sure you guys are like, how the hell did this show, I'm talking about Supernatural, because obviously, but how the hell did this particular program ever make it past anything? Well, it did. And imagine how many failed along the way. It's a hard business to be in. It really is. It is a business of rejection. And you gotta keep moving forward. Somebody says no. I've been in the developmental process now for probably a half a dozen different shows. Winchester's is the only one that I've got on the board. And I've had, there was one that I had with, I mean, the players involved were so highly successful. And it just wasn't the right time. Not that it wasn't good, not that it wasn't, couldn't have been a success, but sometimes it's just timing, you know? If I've got an idea for a show and I have a writer come in and develop it, and then I pitch it to Hulu, and Hulu's like, oh my gosh, we love this idea, but we just bought an idea that's similar, and we don't want competing ideas. So thanks, but no thanks. That's it, bye, see you later. Or I go to, you know, any one of those, it's just, there's so many no's. And I didn't realize that as an actor. I didn't realize how hard it is to have a program be made and then also have a program be successful. It is so difficult. So now that I know that, I am very, very grateful for the career that I've had and hopefully the career that I will have. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to keep my answers a little shorter, so I apologize. Hi.
Hi, Jensen. I really love the new album, and I would love to hear it live. So my question is, are you planning any more live shows, like the Nashville gig?
Thank you. No, not planning anything just yet. I think we wanted to get this album out there, see how it was received, and then go from there. Steve and I have been talking about like what the future holds, and it's kind of up in the air right now, but it's certainly on the table. We really enjoyed ourselves in Nashville, so we're hoping to do something like that again soon. Where, we don't know.
Okay,
But yeah, we'll see. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, Jensen.
Hi.
Some time ago, you told us that you had an idea of making something similar to Naked Gun, and you called it Naked Supernatural. I love this idea, and so I was wondering if you could share something with us. Not naked, I mean the idea.
That's the joke. Could you share the idea?
Naked?
Yeah, we, when, probably the last few seasons of Supernatural, Richard Spate and myself and Rob and Jared and Misha, we all would do slightly different variations of certain takes that were highly comedic and slapstick and stupid and funny. Some of those end up as like bloopers. But we we thought, wouldn't it be funny if we did an entire episode where it was just slapstick? And so we started writing ideas that I may have, no, I don't have my phone on me. I think I have a list of ideas that we came up with that I'll have to, maybe I don't have, I think Richard has it. Spade has it in his phone. Yeah, maybe we'll just compile those together and figure out something to do with it. But it was, you know, I feel like we've almost done some episodes like that already. You know, Yellow Fever or French Mistake or Changing Channels, Mystery Spot. Like those were all kind of irreverent, kind of. There was a lot of slapstick to it, even though it worked within the story. I think there was a lot of silliness to be had. Yeah, I would have always liked to do something like that, but again, we weren't writers on the show. We weren't producers. We weren't executive producers. We weren't studio execs. We weren't network execs. There are so many people you have to go through in order to get something like that done. We probably would have got shot down immediately. Yeah.
Do you remember any examples,
maybe? I knew you were gonna ask that, and I don't. I don't. I mean, we had like. Do you, Tati? Do you have my phone? I'll look it up. I'll take another question. I'll look it up. Did I leave my phone in the green room? Do you have my phone? Correct. I left in the green room. Don't worry about it. It's fine, don't you? Okay, she's gonna go get it. Great. Now we're gonna get to the bottom of this. We'll wait till she comes back. I'll look it up. I'll give it to you.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks. Hi.
Hi. I absolutely love to watch you perform fight scenes.
What is it?
Fight scenes.
Oh, fight scenes.
Because I think your moves and techniques always look so smooth. Powerful and authentic. And I was wondering whether you had any experience or training before you became an actor, and what your favorite fight scene was.
No, I've never had proper training for any kind of like fighting discipline. That being said, I have worked with people who have had extreme experience with fighting disciplines. And I tend to just say, hey, show me what you would do in this situation. And then they would do it, and then I would just mimic that. I always played a lot of sports growing up. I feel like I'm a fairly athletic person, so when somebody challenges me with something physical, I always think that I can do it. whether or not I can do it or not is another thing. But like when somebody when somebody says, hey, can you do this particular move, this fight sequence, this, this, that, and the other, I will try my hardest to do exactly what they envision. So like fight coordinators, or stunt coordinators. Stunt coordinators are responsible for the entire stunt team. They're responsible for the actors whenever they're doing stunts. They're responsible for the stunt performers whenever they're doing stunts. They're responsible for the stunt riggers whenever they're rigging up like wire poles or anything, air rams, whatever it is. They're the head of the department. I will say that the stunt coordinator on Supernatural, we had two. Lou Bolo, God rest his soul, left us. Yep. Yes. Lou was old school stunt guy. Was, you know, one of the stunt guys that, like, you know, throws himself off a galloping horse. But the stunt game changed during his career. And it became less like jump, you know, falling off a horse or getting hit by a car, and it turned into more martial arts, and it turned into more like John Wick stuff, and Lou adapted very well, but he eventually was like, I'm gonna pass it off, and he passed it off to a man named Rob Hader. Rob Hader came in and did amazing things the last few years of Supernatural. And he brought in a discipline, I think, of martial arts into the characters. And you may have noticed that, and you may not have, I don't know. Some of those fight sequences were really intricate, and they were done so in a way that were supposed to be real life, but also camera friendly and film friendly. I was fortunate enough to have two stunt doubles throughout my career at Supernatural. Todd Scott was my first one, who had been with me since Dark Angel. And then he got too popular. So he became Jason Momoa's stunt coordinator. And Todd's doing great, and I love Todd, and I still talk to him to this day. But then in step another stunt double, Jesse Blue, and Jesse came from a martial arts background, and I believe he's probably gonna text me later and be like, "Dude, no, I have," but I think it was like 30 different disciplines.
I think he has his own dojo.
And he has his own dojo. Yes. But he had never done on-camera work with stunts. So it was a great mix of me going, understanding what's gonna look right on camera, and him saying, what would you actually do in real life? So then I would take what a real person would do in a situation, and then I would make it camera friendly and make it film friendly, because his stuff was so tight and so you would never see it from the camera. Be like, they just look like they're, you know, hugging. When really he just dislocated someone's jaw. And so I was like, okay, I understand what you do, but we gotta put space in between us, and it's gotta be big hits, as opposed to like and tying somebody up, and like all of a sudden he's like breaking an ankle, and I'm like, how did that happen? So we worked really well together in combining what he knew with what I knew to then bring it forward. My favorite, I think, stunt sequence was in an episode that I directed, Atomic Monster. It was the beginning sequence where like Dream Dean was fighting his way through the bunker. That wasn't in the script. I've told this story, some of you know this. That wasn't in the script. I just wanted to do something fun. And I wanted to do some big fight sequence. And that's what we came up with. And that was Rob Hayter as stunt coordinator and Jesse as my double. Unfortunately, Jesse didn't get to do a lot of work that day because he's a really good teacher. And he taught me how to do all those moves, and then I was able to execute them because I wanted to. But that was one of my favorite stunt sequences was that. And then I could get into, I'll real quickly get into the boys. Stunt coordinator there is John Koyama. We call him Koi. And Koi is just not just an incredible stunt coordinator. He's like an amazing leader, but also just a wonderful human being. And to get to work with him on these fight sequences that were way bigger than what, like I had like 2 weeks of rehearsal to do some of the stuff that we were doing on the boys. Whereas on Supernatural, I get 20 minutes of rehearsal before we'd actually have to shoot. So I got to really get in there and like give my input. And I will say, and I can say this because he didn't just tell me, he wasn't just giving me lip service, but he really enjoyed my creative input to the fight sequence. Like I was coming up with different moves and I was coming up with different, you know, actions. And he implemented so many of them that he started calling me the fight coordinator. And so much so that when I went to Big Sky, his buddy, Al Gatto, was the stunt coordinator on Big Sky, and Al Gatto and Koi knew each other, so Koi called ahead and was like, hey, you're getting one of my best fight coordinators. And Al made me a Big Sky hat that had fight coordinator written on the back. So. Yeah, I do like my stunts, but I'm also getting a little older, and the falls are getting harder to get up from. But I'm gonna keep doing it. Listen, Harrison Ford and Tom Cruise and those guys can still do it at their age. Then I got a lot of stunt years ahead of me. Okay, next question. But oh, you're still there. Oh, wow. You okay? I thought you'd just go sit down and I'd get back to you, but hey, I'm getting back to you. Hang on. It was called, what was it called? Yep, you're right. I knew Naked was in there somewhere.
Hey Siri, I'm Naked.
Hey Siri. Oh no, it's not, do I not have any service? What's happening?
Yeah, I don't, I'm here.
Shoot.
That's not what you wanted to say.
Hang on. Calm down. alright, I'm not finding it. I'm probably gonna have to like get spanked to.
Okay, maybe later.
Alright, maybe later.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. I'm gonna keep looking while I'm answering other questions. Hi.
Hi. I was wondering, what's your favorite Disneyland or Disney World attraction?
The parking lot. I gave her a shit answer. What is your favorite Disney park attraction? I do know it. I'm gonna give it to you real quick. It is it used to be called the Tower of Terror. It is now, I think it's a Guardians of the Galaxy thing, but it's essentially just an elevator that goes up and then drops you.
That sounds nice.
Yeah, it's, this is gonna sound really bad. I like it so much because it's my wife's most feared nemesis.
That's so great because I was gonna say my favorite attraction is the fireworks that they do in the evening.
That's cute.
Because when I was there with my kids, they ran for cover and started crying.
Well,
this is amazing.
And they were just following what Daddy did. No, it's Tower of Terror.
I took my godson on one of those rides that goes like, it's the loop's a loop, but there's a zero gravity moment in the cycle. And we ran around a couple of times, we were sitting next to each other, and I was like thinking to myself, I'm never, ever, ever getting on one of these again. And he said, Misha, I really have to go to the bathroom. And I said, oh, okay, is it number one or number two? And he said, number three.
Get the puke?
Yeah.
That happened yesterday. To Zeppelin.
Yes.
On the ride from the airport to the hotel. He was in the back seat of the van, and he was doing something. He was playing with like this slime. Does anybody have young kids? Slime? Is that a thing now? Oh, yeah.
It's awful. It's
worse. Anyway. He's like head down, and all of a sudden he just like looks up and he's like, Daddy, my mouth is watering. You know what that means? And I'm like, oh shit. And so I pulled him up with me and the bench in front of him, and I like we literally just stuck his head out the window. And it wasn't because I thought he was gonna throw up. As I was like, you need air in your face.
It is just get away from me.
Yeah, well, yeah. But as soon as like that wind hit, he was like, ah. And then he was just like a dog out the window for like the entire ride into Rome.
We were in the van when he told that story. He tells that story a lot. And we were in the van when
it's fresh.
He told the story. And I was like, where was he sitting when this happened? He said, right where you're sitting. It's a great way to put it, though. It's the best euphemism ever. My mouth is watering.
My mouth is watering. Well, but then he was like, and he made this face, and I was like, oh, he threw up in his mouth. He hadn't. It was just that he didn't want to let it out, because he was like, and I was like, just swallow it, and you can have some water. And he's like,
he's always giving that advice.
It usually works.
I like this because we can. What's the function of this monitor? We can see how we look on the screen.
No, it's actually so that they can see how many times you check yourself
right.
out. Which, to be honest, it's hard to do if you're as narcissistic as you are.
I know, I'm like mesmerized.
I'm seriously sitting here going like, don't look at yourself. Don't do it. Don't even check in. Don't even check. You look fine. If there's something hanging out of your nose, somebody in the front row will tell you. And then I look at the front row here and I'm like, no, they won't. They won't tell me at all. I know these faces. And they'll just hang me out to dry. It's fine.
Are you giving us?
Do I need to leave? I need to leave. Oh, he's crashing the panel to kick. I got it. All right, fine. Guys, thank you so much for putting up with me. I feel like you wanted to ask me a quick question. Just make it real quick, and I'll give you a quick answer. What is it?
I love the last album of Radio Company.
Thank you.
But in the last two,
yes.
Is there a lyric that you wrote that meant something to you?
Yes.
That you could tell us.
Oh, I do. See, that wasn't an easy question.
I said it really quickly
Yeah, you did say it. Yeah. And I applaud you for that. However, I got asked this question earlier, and it's gonna take me some time because there's a few songs on that album. There's a lot of lyrics on that album, and a lot of them mean a lot to me. So I'm gonna have to go back through to kind of listen to it and be like, oh, I remember that's. So that's gonna take that. I know that's kind of like a cop out, but
on the first two.
On the first two.
On the first two.
Oh gosh.
Because every line, it's just every word is just an emotional journey. So I just want to know about the first two.
You know what? Honestly, it's her love is better on the sunny days.
Yes. Because my favorite is his faith in love is will last through
wind, rain, and snow. There you go. It's a good song. Thank you, guys. Misha Collins. Bye, Jensen. Bye, Jensen fans.
Bye, Misha.
Bye, bye, Jensen.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you all?
Sorry, my butt hurts.
It's just like an old jib con, isn't it? Good to be back. What do you want to talk about? Yes, you. You're standing at the microphone.
In my job, it has specifically been for 20 years. So I was just
wondering, can you repeat the question? Sorry, there's a bit of paparazzi in. I'm sorry. No cameras, no pictures, please.
Work Winchester, where I work, it has a specific meaning that predates supernatural by about 100 years, but it feels like it could be supernatural related. So my question is there a word or phrase or slang that you've learned at some point during your career which you find yourself using outside of work or after that job?
Yeah, the phrase motherfucker comes up often. Did you say, can you come closer to the microphone so I can hear
yes,
you?
Yes, sorry.
Winchester?
Yes, Winchester.
What about it?
There's a specific meaning to it where I work. And
where you work?
I'm in Minneapolis.
Okay, what does it mean in where you...
So it means when a fighter jet goes out on a mission and it drops absolutely everything it has, it gives everything it possibly can, and it drops all its bombs, all its guns, and it comes back, and it has nothing left because it's given everything it possibly can to its course, and it comes back to Winchester, and that's a term for World War One that we still use today.
Oh, okay. So you can then you use that as a slang term, meaning just like spent.
Yes.
Or sure, like an empty shell.
Yeah.
Like the Winchesters. Got it. That's useful to know. Thanks. A useless sort of flaccid husk. Yeah, okay. Got it. Thanks, that was a good, useful tidbit. So, was there something that I learned on Supernatural?
Already in the job you've done, like Stonehenge Apocalypse, because I loved doing that. Very similar. Yeah.
It's a robot head, I think. I don't know that there. No, not really. We have little like movie isms, like phrases that we use on set. Like copy that means I gotcha. I say that in regular life, and usually people basically know what I'm talking about, but often they don't. I mean, do you use the phrase Winchester? Speaking to civilians? No.
Yeah, like sometimes.
Really? So they just don't know what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I didn't have a better answer. Hi.
Hi. Hello. My question is, because Cass didn't get to tell goodbye to Sam before he died,
So I was wondering if Cass could tell anything to Sam before he died, what would you tell him?
Take care of your brother. Too soon. Sorry. Hi.
So we know thanks to your resume some of your special skills. So I was wondering, do you have any special skills that you didn't add to your resume because you thought nobody's going to hire me for knowing how to do this?
Or knowing how to do this, things that I didn't put on my resume?
Yeah, for example, like touching the tip of your nose with your tongue. Stuff like that. Random shit like that.
I can't touch my nose with my tongue.
Me either.
Thanks for bringing that up. That's a sore subject for me. Is that something you can do?
No, I can do creepy stuff with my
You can
fingers.
Do creepy stuff? That's okay. My son can pretty much pick his nose with his tongue. It's really gross. Yeah, I can do this. I can also do other creepy things with my tongue, but I won't talk about those. Hi.
Hey, Misha. Firstly, just wanted to say congrats on Road Food getting the Taste Award for both Best Food and Travel Series.
Thank you.
Incredibly well deserved. My question is, going into season one, I know you've said that you wanted to explore how food brings people together, how we're more alike than we are different. If there were to be a season two, is there anything that you would like to explore?
Well, I think so. I mean, we were using this sort of guidepost of a word, which was empathy, for the structure of season one, which was basically like trying to understand the other, I think, in broad, abstract terms. But going into a second season, I think it would be more interesting to look for something a little bit more specific, which is common ground. In the United States, as many of you know, we're very polarized and kind of, it's like we're on two opposing sports teams, and people who are on one side hate everything about people who are on the other side, and they don't even see each other as human anymore. It's become so polarized. And it's getting more and more extreme as time goes on because of various different apparatuses in our political system. So I'm kind of interested in finding the things where there's common ground and trying to expose those, because I think that's more interesting than how we're different, because everybody focuses on that, and ultimately focusing on the differences ends up driving people further apart. I think that when you find common ground, when you discover a shared humanity, like, oh, well, you also like tacos, could be a good starting point. But then you start to form these little tendrils, these little bridges that can actually start to dissolve the polarity. And I don't know, I mean, there have been times in recent years in my country where it feels like we might be on the brink of a civil war. When the pandemic hit, felt like it might be a tipping point for us, like people might actually start killing each other. And we did have a lot of riots and a lot of big protests, and they got more violent than riots or protests have gotten in a long time. And I think that's because we have become so polarized that it's like it's exploding at the seams. So it feels somewhat urgent to me, and I feel like I'm poking around to try to find ways to be useful in that realm. But road food is a Trojan horse for me, because it's really not about food; it's about culture and society and politics and. You know, learning about one another and bridging divides.
I think that's what makes it so important. So fingers crossed for season two.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hope you're well. A couple of weeks ago, you posted a picture with a tie knot that you got from Jennifer Maynickel,
yeah,
and you never announced which one it was.
That wasn't very nice of me.
Yeah.
Do you know what it was?
I'm guessing it was the average time.
Why are you guessing that?
Because I googled it.
Did you google what knot was that Misha was wearing?
No.
You googled, how did you google it?
I googled tie knots and just looked through all of them.
And then you compared and contrasted and you got the answer. It was the Eldridge.
So you're gonna follow me or
that's,
what?
That's the announcement. Yes, yes.
No, don't. That's scary. Shut up.
What? So at
no,
what?
No, 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 thank you, bye.
So I actually don't want to embarrass her. What is her handle? At Living Far Away. Okay, at Living Far Away. Can't wait. You might want to scrub your profile because I'm coming for you. Hi.
My question is also sort of about road food.
Okay.
We saw that recently it tied with Gordon Ramsay's show, which congrats about that.
Thanks. It would have been nicer to beat him, but.
So since we have evidence that Mason and West are great cooks, from, you know, cooking with Mason and West, if you could bring them to
work
for us, Gordon Ramsay, what recipe would you pick?
What would they pick to cook? Pasta with jam sauce, probably. It'll really stump him, I think.
Thanks.
Hi.
Hold on, wait. Here we go. I had a comment and a question about Bridgewater. So the comment is just, I really loved season one. I haven't had a chance to listen to the new season, and you were so good. And honestly, I didn't expect an audio-only radio drama to carry me away as much as it did. So my question is, are you considering doing more voice acting in addition to film acting?
I would love to do more voice acting. I found that way more satisfying than I thought it would. I was actually kind of nervous about it because I haven't really done much voice acting, and I thought it would feel artificial and be really challenging. And I got into the recording booth and I found it really natural. And strangely liberating. I quite liked it. Yeah.
Please do more opportunities come your way.
Well, thank you very much.
Well, we have a chance to travel a lot and experience a lot of countries, cultures, and fans from different countries, of course. So I wanted to know, if you were not bound by family and your job, what country would you consider living in?
Living in?
Yes.
Oh, shit. I haven't even allowed myself to think about that because I'm so bound by my children who are stuck in California. I don't know. I would love to live for some time with the kids in different places. So I would love to be able to take them, like, to live with indigenous tribes in the Amazon for 6 months, or go live in New Zealand and shear sheep, because it's just so beautiful. But I would love to be in a culture that feels very different from our own. I was listening to a podcast recently, and I don't remember what podcast or who said it, and so I should be doing a better job of crediting here, but someone was saying that we in the West think that all of civilization has been on this arc of progression that has culminated with this moment in time and our civilization. But in fact, there are 7,000 languages spoken on the globe, and each one of those languages represents the apex of a different culture that has also been evolving through time and evolving to this moment in time. And they all offer a panoply of different things that are absolutely enriching. And we are stuck on this idea that everybody should be trying to conform. I mean, I'm speaking as an American right now because I think we're the worst of it, but we're operating with this on this assumption that everybody should be trying to conform to our version of civilization and our
our vision for how an economy should operate and an education system should operate, and that everybody should speak English. As an American, I come here and I'm just like, speak English, people. I mean, it's terrible. And nobody in the U.S. learns foreign languages. It's kind of terrible. So I'd love to spend some time in a wildly different culture, because once you spend time in a very different culture and civilization, it starts to make you realize, oh, there's other options out there. We don't have to be like this. We can be different. It was very profound for me. I was fortunate to be able to travel a fair amount when I was younger. Not super young, but you know, as soon as I could scrape, like save the money to buy an around the world ticket, I spent a good amount of time in India and Nepal and Tibet and Bali and Thailand and sort of like traveled around the world. And it was, especially India for me, India was like, oh, wow, the world could be completely different. And I'd love to have my kids have that experience. And it's not the same as like vacation. You have to spend solid amount of time somewhere to start to have that percolate into you, I think. Anyway.
Thank you. Hi, Misha.
Hi.
I just wanted to ask, we haven't seen you in the lineup for JIB13 yet. Is there any chance you're going to make it? Do you know anything?
I have to just figure out when I can see my kids, and I haven't figured out my schedule for that yet. So if I have my kids at that time, I won't be able to come. So I'm just waiting to see what's going on with that schedule. Yeah, thanks. I would love to be back. Hi.
Hey, it's about Bridgewater. I'm a fan of Melissa Ponzio, and I wanted to know how it's like to work with her to record the show.
I think she was amazing. It was great. It was great because my character and her character on the show got to like meet each other right around the same time that I was getting to meet her, and then the characters and we as actors sort of evolved along a trajectory. So it was really cool. She's super talented, and it was a real treat working with her.
That's cool. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi.
Hi, Misha. So what's the story behind the Gucci jackets you're wearing?
Daniela gave them to us as gifts, and I had it on last night because I was cold, and then Jensen was like, hey, what the, I have a jacket just like that. And then Jared was like, wait a minute, I have a jacket just like that. And so we accidentally discovered how not special we are. And then we thought it would be funny to wear them all together today. We did a lot of marketing for Gucci today.
Yeah. You did. We appreciate it.
Uh-huh.
Hi. Speaking of different cultures and languages, can you say Zdravete, which is in Bulgarian means hi?
Zdravete.
Zdravete.
Zdravete. What?
Zdravete.
Zdravete.
Yes, that's great. Awesome, thank you.
That took a lot longer than it should have. I'm sorry. I just recorded a video in Ukrainian. Zelensky has a nonprofit that he's trying to get donations from abroad for Ukrainians, but he also broadcast on state TV a message from a bunch of celebrities, including myself. So yesterday on Ukrainian state TV, they broadcast this message of support to the Ukrainian people. And I was like, oh, you know what I think I'll do for this? I'll do it in Ukrainian. And I wrote something short, and then I found this app where you can get a translator. And so I had this Ukrainian woman on the app helping me translate. And then I had a little recording of her saying the dialogue. And it took me like 3 hours to say 2 sentences because the pronunciation was so difficult. And then it was like, I guess, broadcast on state TV in Ukraine. And I'm sure It's completely unintelligible. My accent is so bad that they can't understand what I'm saying. Oh, it was, could you really understand what I was saying? You're just saying that. Oh, that's good to hear. Thanks for, thank you. Oh, they said that I did it well? That was very charitable of them. Are you living in Ukraine now? Did your family move from Portugal, or?
Just my sister and my nephew.
Where were you living?
Near
Ukraine. No, in Ukraine. Where is that?
It's
Eastern. Oh, okay. Well, sorry for what's happening to your country. Sincerely hope that it doesn't go on forever. I hope we can find an end to this. I hope that there can be some treaty at some point. It's really heartbreaking to see. Yeah, sending love to you. Sorry. You know, when we have little periods of peace, like Europe saw since World War II, you start to develop hope. Like maybe we're evolving past this. Maybe we don't have to fight wars anymore. But history keeps proving that there's something in the hardwiring of governments that they can't keep peace. It's really heartbreaking. It's awful to feel so powerless to try to figure out what the hell we can do from afar. But there are little things we can do, I keep reminding myself, if everybody just tries to do some small thing, it will add up to making a big difference. But we have to see ourselves as like little pieces in a grander puzzle here. Anyway, sorry.
Hi. I'm sorry because my question is silly.
Thank God.
Love Ukrainian, anyway. So, Castiel, Jeremy Bradshaw, and Arvidant, what can you about? What happened?
Oh my God. Well, first of all, they were all like, oh my God.
Yeah.
I was a triplet? How did we not know about this? I noticed that there are some similarities between all three of those characters. And I really have myself to blame for that. It's a funny experience as an actor, having been playing one character. I know that Castiel had different variations, and you know there are different versions of Castiel over the years. But having played one character for so long, I started to wonder, like, I don't know if I can even do anything else anymore. Like, maybe this is it for me. Maybe I can just do Castiel, and I shouldn't hang up my hat now. So, doing Bridgewater and working on Gotham Knights has been nice for me, because I realized not all characters are Castiel. And I can do something else, which is kind of great. Bridgewater was a really lovely but very brief experience, because you know you can get through that so fast. And Gotham Knights, I'm really happy with the show. I mean, I can't wait to hear what people say about it, as long as they say something positive. But I will say I'm gonna prime the pump about Gotham Knights, which is, I think it gets better as the season goes on. Like, I think that's pretty normal with a new show. Like, we're finding our feet in the first couple of episodes, and I still think the first couple of episodes are great. But as we get further into the season, I think it gets really good, especially
my arc, which I'm narcissistic, so nobody laughed. So getting to like play this character that really unravels over time, and he's losing his mind, and he's literally fighting his own inner demons, and that's playing out on the screen. It was exhilarating to do as an actor, and it was really fun. So look forward to hearing your thoughts on that.
Okay.
And also, what do you think would happen when they walk into a bar?
Probably Jeremy would pass all the time trying to convince himself that Castiel doesn't exist.
That's a good point. Yes, Jeremy would say, this isn't real, this isn't happening, you people are crazy. Harvey Dent / Two-Face would say, yes, I am crazy. And then Castiel would drink them both under the table.
Because this morning I wasn't at your panel, unfortunately, because I lost my plane. And so I had to come later.
You lost your plane?
Yes. My 6 a.m.
Where did I put my plane?
Yeah, it was very difficult to find, but finally I managed. So I arrived. And a friend told me that you mentioned that once you had a dream about Castiel, and so we were wondering if that was actually what happened. You had a dream about Castiel, and if you were Castiel in the dream, or if you were like seeing Castiel in the dream or something, or if it was a nightmare, or I don't know.
I had a few dreams about Castiel over the years.
Did you dream about Sam Winchester?
No, I had many, many dreams about Sam Winchester.
Tell me more.
Well, in my culture,
si?
They call them wet dreams.
Ah. What was Sam Winchester in your dreams? What was his influence? It's been years. Ladies and gentlemen, Misha Collins. I love that the music came out. Hi guys, sorry to interrupt the question. God, I wish you... Misha, you didn't answer the question. I interrupted like a jackass. Sorry. Medes Piaggi. Che cazzo fa? You can ask me Misha's question, and I will answer for it. Who asked that?
Do you dream about Castiel?
Did I dream about Castiel? Did I ever? Luckily, I could wake up and see him, so it was well, hello there. I don't know, where did he end, left or right? He ended left, so I'll be right back, but I'm going to start right. Long left for you. This way.
Hi, Darren.
Hi.
First, I haven't heard anybody ask about Walker yet, so I have a question about Walker.
All right. I'm still walking. Look at this.
Show off.
On the new show. When I started watching it, I just fell in love with the music on it. Whoever picks the music for that show, kudos. Kudos to that one.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Not me, but yes.
Well,
thank you on their behalf.
And I have to say, the way I used to watch the old Walker, Texas Ranger. I prefer Walker.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we it was a weird, thank you. It was an interesting kind of transition from Sam to Walker. I had many months during the pandemic because we already, when Jensen and I were sent home from Vancouver for the pandemic, you know, I already knew basically the entire last episode and a half, which we had left to film, of Supernatural. And so I was able to work for like 5 months trying to figure out this character. And I think we had some questions earlier. I know I've had some in other cities. A lot of what I do on Walker, I wouldn't have been comfortable doing before working with Jensen. Like seeing him kind of have fun with scenes and kind of make it his own. I really kind of took notes, I guess, subconsciously. And now I'm just having a good time. I hope I get to keep doing it.
And I also love the chemistry between Walker and Cassie.
Yeah, she's rad.
Hysterical.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm wondering if there is any difference between how you get into the role of Walker and how you used to get into the role of Sam.
Great question. Logistically, no. I have an idea of who Cordell Walker is, and so I had a pretty decent idea of who Sam is, and I feel like in a couple of days' time, I could easily get back into Sam. I could do Sam right now, but I...
Freezing.
I would need a... There's me right here. I'm pointing at the camera, but I see my face. I look like I flew all night. I feel I need longer hair, but my method is kind of the same. I kind of, it's remained the same since I was Dean, OG Dean. Original gangster Dean on Gilmore Girls. But I just kind of read it, let it swim around, and then I get to set and throw it all away and see what works. So I, in general, I'll kind of like read a script many times in a row, and then on the day I'm filming those scenes, I'll just work on those scenes. And then I'll get to set, and we'll block, and we'll always find out. You know, if I was to say like, hey, we're gonna shoot a scene where we're walking down the street. And in your head, you're like, okay, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna grab a piece of pizza, I'm gonna do that. And then you get to the location where you're actually filming, and there's no pizza, and you're not really walking that far, you just kind of bob and leave. And so there have been so many times on Walker, like I feel like if you were to have the script for any episode of Walker, and then watch the episode, you'd be like, I don't see any of these words, you know, like I don't see these lines. We just kind of bob and weave and flow. So that's been really nice to do. But it's otherwise it's pretty similar.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Hi.
Hi.
So I wanted to ask, so when Dean died, he got to have a goodbye speech.
Oh, we're going there. Great.
So I wanted to know if Sam died, what would his goodbye speech be?
Fuck you. Cats are fine. No, just teasing. I think Sam's speech to Dean would have been a combination of, was it Bloodlust? Was it which was the episode where they're locked in the motel room and Gordon is after them? Bloodlust. And they're putting the mattresses. And he's like, well, you're my brother, you know, like that whole bit. What's it called? Fresh Blood. Would have been a combination of what he said to Dean and Fresh Blood. What he said to Dean and Sacrifice. And what he said to Dean and I forget the name of the episode, but it was the hardest scene for me ever to shoot. I couldn't remember. There was a scene on something. and loss, yes. The scene of being a profit and loss. Kind of a combination of those three. But I think Sam also would have said to Dean, even if Sam was the one who was bleeding out or gonna bleed out and die, I think he would have said, it's okay, you can go. You know, I think Sam knew and might know again that Dean wouldn't have lived a long life without Sam, in my opinion. I think Dean was around keeping his brother safe. And Sam knew, I think Dean knew that Dean wanted to be there for Sam, and he also knew that Sam had something else other than hunting that he was destined to do. So I think if Sam had to say, I'm gone, man, because honestly, when Jeremy Carver and Bob Singer and Jensen Ackles and I sat down together before season 15 and talked about the finale, in my head, Sam was going to be the one to die. Because that's its own tragedy, where Dean brought his brother back to hunt and be part of the life, and then I thought it'd be so interesting to see Dean have to cope with the idea that Sam died because Dean brought him back into the life. Y'all want to see that?
Yes.
I want to see that.
Yes.
Maybe we will. But I think Sam would have tried to make sure, like, hey, dude, I know you've been here for me, sacrificed a lot for me. When you need to go, just go. I'll be waiting for you. Yeah, thank you.
Hi, good to see you. Looking so well.
Looking well right now?
Well, no,
have you not seen
the... I mean, it's been a while now. I've seen nothing.
Car accident and all that shit.
Just a quick one. Nothing about Sam. Really enjoying Walker and Windy. Windy was one of the surprise. Loving it.
Makes me cry.
And I just wonder if there's any plans to make it available on TV outside the United States?
The short answer is hell yes. The shorter answer is I have zero votes in that. So, executive producer or not, like I would love for it to be available everywhere. I think Windy is such a beautiful show, and I'm obviously so proud of Walker, and I've done so much work on it. So I would love for everybody. So I tried. Last night when I got home from dinner, my body was at like 2 p.m. Texas time or something. And so I was like, well, I'll just go ahead and rewatch, because I watched Walker and Windy in a fucking airport lounge in Atlanta. And so I was like, let me just go ahead and double check and see the episode again. And I don't understand it. But it wouldn't let me watch it because I'm in Italy. Yeah. This is not available in your area. I'm a fucking producer. If I knew who to call, I'd call up.
Who'd you like to?
I wish I knew. I've got a long letter. It'd be very obnoxious.
Really enjoyed them, then.
Thank you.
Somehow. Yeah.
Yeah. Well,
thank you.
We'll work on that. Yeah. Thanks so much. Hi.
Hey. I was just wondering, in following the 15 seasons as much as possible, and trying to separate yourself from the character if possible, that if Sam and Dean were to go completely solo hunting during the course of Supernatural, who do you think would make it closest to season 15?
That's a great question. Well, you know, Sam... Dean was more run-and-gun style. Sam was more, let me try and research and figure out the best way to approach this style. And Sam had to, you know, be possessed by Meg, be possessed by Lucifer, by Gadriel, Ezekiel. And Dean got killed by rebar that didn't move.
Congratulations.
the hardest one to shoot for you?
I wish, for those who have seen Walker, I think it was season 1, episode 9, the flashback of Captain James pulling the sheet off of dead Emily, Jen, and Steve Robin, who directed it, he wouldn't let me see Jen once her makeup, once her dead death makeup was done. And so he made the whole crew get quiet, and we had like a minimal skeleton crew, we call it. And so the first time I saw Jen was that first take. And like Kobe broke down in tears, Odette Animal broke down in tears. I was a wreck. That was hard. That sucked. That sucked. That was tough. Yeah, that for sure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
This is a really random, stupid question.
I love it.
I'm a big wrestling fan, a professional wrestling fan, so I wondered if you were a professional wrestler, what would your ring name be, and what song would you... I mean, there's already a professional wrestler called Moose, so I think that's bacon.
Fuck him.
could you beat him in a fight? He's pretty big.
Did you not just hear? I beat Lucifer. And God. I'd be the we have some Polish fans in here. What's Polish moose?
Wash?
Is, can you say, can it sound cooler? Like killer wash or something? Killer wash. How do you say killer in Polish?
Wash
na fujta. Oh, come on, that's badass.
The second part of the question was, what would your entrance song be? What song would you come out to hip hop?
That's good. Not wash na fujta, because if that song exists, it shouldn't. There's a great song, so before I tore my knee up, I was kind of getting back into doing back work and stuff, like heavy back. And there's a song from the Deadpool. I've never seen Deadpool.
What?
No, I hear it's amazing. I gotta watch it, I know. Kmart, chill out. I've never seen it, I'm going to watch it. I don't have a whole lot of time in my hands, but I'm going to watch it. But there's a song, what's that song called? There's a song in Deadpool, the soundtrack, I don't know if it's one or two, called...
Angel of the Morning?
No. It's like, dum 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 dum. Something about a party. It's a party. It's called...
No. The only thing I can think of is DMX.
No. There's a song on the Deadpool soundtrack, and it starts out, it's pretty... Like, I use it... when I'm trying to work out these days, which I can't really do for my day. But...
Sing it.
There's somebody... I don't know what the lyrics are. I just know the bass line is like... It starts out... Dum 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 dum.
You have stumped us.
Come on, guys! Y'all booed me for not watching Deadpool and you don't know the name of the song.
You stumped us.
I
was
that because I've also not watched Deadpool, so...
Shoot. Did somebody know it? Welcome to the party. Welcome to the party. Yeah. Yes. It's a. Yeah. I think. I hope that's right. I think that sounds right. Yeah.
Welcome to the
party.
Thank you very much. Love you.
Love you back. Thank you very much. Hi there.
So we know Guarina and Sam had chemistry,
mm-hmm.
and when you found out Sam was going to kill Guarina, were you hoping it'd be the same way you killed Madison and Jess and everyone
else? Wow. Will you grab the knife out of my bag?
I mean, what a way to go though.
that was a really... So, I think anybody in here who has had the pleasure of meeting Ruthie loves her. I certainly love and adore her. and both as a human being and as a fellow actor. And so when I read that script, that was a tough one also. And I, you know, we were in that time of the series where we were kind of like killing people off and saying goodbye to them, and it all sucked. I was really, it felt appropriately intimate, if that makes any sense. So I think that was the right way to do it, because it felt like a connection. Yeah, I think I wouldn't have written it any other way.
Yeah, yeah. It's a beautiful scene. Definitely.
Thank you so much. I'll pass it on to Ruthie. Thank you. Well, hello there.
Hi, Jared. Just some random question. As a tallish guy.
Tallish?
Yeah, tall. Like,
oh, tallish. Yeah. Me, yeah.
Or dollish.
Accents. I didn't know. No, I got it. I'm
quite sorry. Tall.
Yes.
Out of snow.
Yeah, what do you mean ish? Come on, yeah. Use some credit.
Okay, so out of Snow White and Seven Dwarfs, which one of the dwarfs would you be? And which Sam would be?
I'd be Dopey, Sam would be Grumpy.
Grumpy is really
good. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
That's an awesome question. Hi there.
Hi, Jared. I have an early season Sam question, if that's okay.
Fine.
In season 3's Bad Day at Black Rock.
Yeah.
You know, where you fell down.
Rabbit's Foot.
Yeah, the Rabbit's Foot thing. Yeah, that's one of my daughter's favorite episodes. She watches it with me now. She's 17 now.
She likes seeing me in pain, yeah.
Yeah. She was 7 at the time and she said, let's watch the one where Sam falls down. And she wanted to know, did you really hurt your knees when you fell? Because it was so real looking. And she's always wondered that.
Oh, really?
Thought I'd ask that, so thanks.
That's awesome. Well, that actually makes me feel really good. Because, well, the short answer is no, I don't know how many is. The long answer is if we come out of, was it Bigger Sins at the time?
Yes.
Yeah. So when we came out of Bigger Sins.
You were chasing Bella.
Yeah, and we're running. So there was a stunt pad, which are pads probably about like 12 to 18 inches. Like, you know, people jump out of buildings or something and fall on them. And so it was out of camera, and the camera was here so I could fall. But it was basically, if you watch the shot, you can tell where it is, because it's this wide.
Yeah.
And probably from me to the front row. And so they laid it there. And so if the camera's here, we're running out, we're doing this. And then I pretend to fall, I fell onto like a double mattress, like a giant.
But it was so funny, you just disappeared from the screen.
Yeah.
It was just so well done. And she's always loved that, so have I. So.
Yeah, I'm an overactor.
Yeah. Anyway, thanks.
Made a career out of it. Thanks
so much.
And thanks to your daughter. Hi there.
I have a supernatural question as well. So we never get to find out why Poughkeepsie is such an important word to Sam and Dean. Did you guys know that? Did you make anything up in your heads? Did you kind of make a backstory for that?
That was, great question. That was courtesy of Bob Singer. I think Poughkeepsie is somewhere in New York.
Yes.
Yes, yes, I knew that. So it originally came from Bob Singer, and then the second time where I say Poughkeepsie to Dean, it's not in the script, but I thought it would be a cool thing to add. I think the nerd in Jared was like, this is the perfect time to like close the loop. And a lot of the stuff I do now on Walker and Wendy as a producer, but also even during Supernatural, some of the things I like doing, like I think Jensen and I have talked about some of the throwbacks to in the barn scene that we all know about, but the bit, you know, bits where, you know, I can't do this alone. Yes, you can. Well, I don't want to. That's not scripted. That was just something I wanted. I was like, this is a great way to close the circle. Hey, Sam, Dean, which is the first words we ever see them say to each other, was just something I wanted to kind of close that loop. It's just storytelling. Like I don't love acting. I love storytelling. I love stories. And so I think as somebody who enjoys stories, that just seemed like pieces of the puzzle, but it's like that final feeling. Have y'all made puzzles before? I'm sure y'all have. You know when it's mostly built and then you're putting in the final pieces and you're like, oh, that's where it goes, and you turn it around. That's that, like, I love that feeling. I was always a kid, and my middle child, my younger son Shep, he's very similar with like Legos or with puzzles. And I was the same way as a kid. He'll spend days or weeks building this puzzle or Legos or whatever, and then once it's done, he wants us to see it, and then he wants to break it down. And you're like, dude, you spend so much time. Like, you've been here every day after school, on the weekends. But that was me. It was kind of like, okay, I want to figure this puzzle piece out, and cool, all right, let me make something else. And so Poughkeepsie, the second time it came around, was just something that kind of occurred to me when I was reading it. But the first time was courtesy of Bob Singer, our New York born and bred executive producer, director.
Cool, that's really great, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Hi, Jared. My question is, so Jensen is in The Boys now. Jeffrey Dean Morgan.
Yes,
Jeffrey Dean Morgan is coming too. So if you were to be in that show, would you be part of The Boys or The Seven? And would you kick Soldier Boy's ass, or would you help him? And Soldier Boy, not Jensen.
No, I understand. I don't know if I would want to fight Soldier Boy. He was mean. But I don't want to get thrown onto a table like the butcher. Kripke and I have talked a little bit about how I could do it. Right now it's not practical logistically, you know. I'd love to be on it. I'd have to call my mom and say, don't watch. For sure.
Jensen did that.
He did, yeah. He gave me all the notes, like, hey, if you ever do it, just call your friends, call your wife, call your mom, say, don't watch. I'd love to do it. I think it would be fun to link up with Soldier Boy and kind of solve something together. So I think I'd have to be one of the suits. Yeah.
Jacket best.
You do.
Last man standing.
Seeing as I'm the only one here, I'd say it's me. I think I'm 40 years old. I don't believe I've ever owned a Gucci jacket. And I don't know, it took me so long.
It suits you well.
Thank you.
Hi, Jared.
Hey.
I'm gonna take you to the beginning of this season of Walker.
Okay.
Where you're in the cage and you're being tortured.
Yeah, the good old Jared Padalecki in a cage.
Yeah. And it was amazing. It was absolutely amazing. And I'm curious, how hard was it for you not to draw from Sam? Because when I watched that, it was very hard for me.
Yeah.
And I did not see Sam. So I'm just curious, was it tough for you?
Amazing, thank you. I mean, the thought absolutely crossed my mind. In a weird way, and I'm sorry to keep using bad language, but I feel like Cordell Walker almost has a bit more of a fuck you attitude than Sam. Like, Walker has a bit of Dean in him of like, bring it. Whereas Sam was very much, I don't know, almost academic with like, here's where I am, here's what I have to do.
He's defiant, I think.
Cordell,
Sam is.
Yeah, Sam's defiant, but Sam is thinking all along, like, what's the intelligent way out of here? Cordell has a bit more of like, well, I guess this is it. But obviously when they bring Liam into the cage, very similar to Dean and Sam in the cage, on a personal note, that cage was real. Like, that was real metal. Often when you see cages, it's a lot of like styrofoam, like firm styrofoam that's been painted and speckled. To look like it's old corrugated iron or something. This was just iron and concrete, and it sucked. And since I was wearing shorts and like a skinny black t-shirt, I couldn't wear pads, and so it sucked. And that's when I also tore my Achilles, or not Achilles, my ACL. But it's what it is.
You did an amazing job, and thank you for everything you do.
Thank you, Beth.
Thank you.
Well, here we go.
Hey, how's it going?
Good.
I wanted to let you know that I was the handler for Chuck Norris a couple of years ago. And I told him how well Walker was doing, and he just wanted to pass along that he was so proud.
Oh, that's awesome. That's really cool. So, I was invited to go be a part of a con in the States that he was doing, and I'm out of town for a wedding or something, but I can't, I've actually still never met him. You know, we've talked through this person and that person, but it's fun to follow in footsteps, but also pave your own way, if that makes any sense. So it means a lot. Cool. I hope he was nice. I'm sure he was. I bet. Awesome. I still wouldn't mess with him. Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
Since we all agree the supernatural feat will happen eventually.
Oh, we do agree then?
We do.
Yeah. News to me.
What kind of plot lines would you like to see happen?
Sam Dry's Dean Harlow.
What's it?
Sam Dry's Dean Harlow.
Sam Fry's Dean?
Dry's Dean Harlow.
Oh, Sam Drives the Impala. there's a lot in my head, and there's a lot. I want to get, I'm sure I'm on record. Oh, on record, that sounds self-important. I think I've expressed how much I would love to do that sometime. I will say this, I don't want to say but,
stop.
I just did three butts in a row. But I feel so protective. And I feel so protective of what Jensen and I did with that supernatural storyline of those characters that I feel like he and I would need to have the heaviest hands in the storylines. And so we never did. We were never producers, much less executive producers on Supernatural. We behaved very much like producers, or even executive producers. I was gonna say the B word.
But.
However. on the other hand, I really feel like I have some strong thoughts on the best way to do it. And he and I have talked and shared ideas. I mean, I don't feel like the supernatural, I wouldn't want it to be a movie. I would want it to be like a 6 to 8 episode, maybe hour and a half reboot. I don't think it would be complete without Castiel. I don't think it would be complete without Jack. You know, I don't think it would be complete without, you know, so many of the beloved characters we've had, especially towards the end there, where the storyline makes the most sense to kind of not jump back in, but jump back in. I hope we get to explore that.
Me
yeah,
too.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Love you. Bye.
Hi.
Hi.
mean the original first thing?
OG. Yeah.
First, thank you for giving Walker such a depth and humanity. Because it's really great. Thank you.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask, since you have kids usually watch a lot of movies and cartoons all over.
I'm so sorry.
They watch cartoons and movies.
Yes, right? Yours or mine?
Have you been stuck in there watching with them again? Because I was wondering if, as for myself, I got some lessons from, I don't know, the Lion King, Baltor, and I was wondering if you can think of something that was a strong message for yourself.
From the Lion King?
From whatever movie you think is important for you.
Yeah, you know what's funny is that I heard Lion King, and I wrote my senior graduation English paper on the Lion King, working in Joseph Campbell's, you know, heroes, myths, and legends, and all the archetypes, and then got to kind of portray a lot of those with Supernatural, and I never thought about this. So my senior, you know, advanced English placement paper was comparing The Lion King and The Natural with Robert Redford and talking about the different use of archetypes and two different kind of genres, because one was with, you know, animation and one was live action, and they were a couple decades apart, or a decade plus. And so I think I really love the classic archetypes and stories, the classic tropes and different takes on them. And so I find myself drawn to stories that have kind of an inherent juxtaposition. That's maybe a weird word in an Italian. I feel like, you know, the friendly beast, you know, the Chewbacca that's scary, or, you know, the Timon and Pumbaa that are strange and Pumbaa farts. But the friendly
someone.
Giardumba. Right now.
I'm guilty of that too. So a friend of mine called him Jared, the tiny Jared.
The tiny Jared?
Yeah. Let's not go there.
Yeah, I think I learned from some of those movies and some of the kids' movies. I think kids' movies are very simplistic at their core because they deal with things and I imagine that people who create and produce kids' movies, kids' TV shows, they understand that certain storylines work. You know, the bully who ends up being a nice guy, the nerd who ends up being the hero, et cetera, et cetera. And so I think humans are all drawn to those tropes. So yeah, I've learned a lot, but now I've got to go back and watch and make some notes. Thank you.
Hi, Robinson. And so I've asked this question last August to Jensen.
I wasn't here in August.
Yes, I know, and I asked him to answer on your behalf.
Oh, great.
And he did. But he also said you might have a very long, insightful answer to that question, so here it goes. What aspect of Sam and Dean's personality was hardest to act? But
oh,
for
wow.
You, it's Sam's personality, obviously.
Yeah, got it. Man, he really built me up. I'm going to fail. what was the hardest aspect of Sam for me to portray? Gosh, a lot of Sam came pretty naturally to me. And I think that's a credit to our writers. They kind of get to know who you are and get to know how you lean when you're doing a scene. I can't tell you how many times in the final probably 10 seasons of Supernatural, it's like Sam and Dean show up to a person's house. Hey, we want to ask you about your deceased, this person or that person. It's like Sam does his empathetic puppy dog eyes. And I was like, oh, okay, we're going to, but I think that's kind of who Jared is. I think it was Sam's version of comedy. Because Sam, I don't think, was a really funny guy. He had some really funny moments. I think Cordell Walker's version of comedy is very similar to Jared Padalecki's. And I just spoke in the third person. But, you know, I think Sam's version of comedy was difficult for me to kind of find. And maybe that was correct, because Sam, I don't think, thought of himself as a funny person. It was kind of more funny in the moment. And so I think that's probably it. Like, I think I've said before, The French Mistake was the most nerve-wracking episode of Supernatural that I've ever done. Now, the finale was obviously the most difficult episode, but the most nerve-wracking was like, okay, this is a funny episode. I was like, what? What do you mean? Like, Sam has to be funny? So that's my answer. I hope it lived up to Jensen's expectations.
Jensen said it would be having a taller older brother.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, his older brother, Josh. Oh, yeah. And I guess for me, it'd be having a shorter older brother, because my brother's taller than I am. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Oh, look, I'll do one more. I'm getting the guillotine, but of course. Great question, thank you. My favorite part about Sam's personality was his, this is an American and or English saying, but his long game mentality. You know, he kind of helped teach me patience. I'm not gonna claim I'm the most patient person on the planet. I think I'm all right, but he always wanted to do things right, to do things the correct way, and he was willing to put in the work before attempting so that he wouldn't mess up. My favorite part of Cordell's personality, Walker's personality, I like Cordell's sense of humor. It's very similar to Jared's. He's kind of a goofball. He doesn't take himself, not that Sam took himself seriously, and that's not how I would word it. He was dealing with much more serious situations, but I love how Cordell doesn't seem to take himself seriously. So that's been fun. It's been a lesson in itself. Thank you. And thank you all. I guess I'm coming up. See y'all tomorrow. Jacket, and rock YouTube events. So, love you all. Thank you so much.
Love you back.